It's an honor to be here today to share with you my life and history, that your today and tomorrow may be stronger. And in beginning, I'm honored to be able to be back. And being around Springfield and the Chatham area, I've been reading and I've been listening to a few statements that I have heard. I've been observing what people have been saying about my husband. And I would like to begin with the fact that there is new data out that people are saying that Stephen Douglas was a finer orator than what they had suspected. And that perhaps it meant that my husband was less of an orator than had been thought. I want to change that statement. Stephen Douglas was a wonderful orator. And the more you learn of him, you're going to find how excellent he really was on his feet, as well as the written word. There's a difference between the written word and the spoken word. When we speak, we use half sentences, sometimes one word. Our expressions and our reputation stand with us with the spoken word. With the written word, the editing of the Stephen and Douglas debates, and that was printed, it was necessary in order for a reader who hadn't attended a debate to get it across on the written word what they could not get with inflection. I stand in that my husband was even that much a greater orator of his day. Being with Stephen Douglas and being put up against him, because Stephen Douglas had the reputation from the family that he came from, and my husband did not have that. He went on his own education, on his own deductions. And when he was 10, did you know that he could do the work of six men? His papa was so hard on him that by doing so much work at home, it afforded him the right to be able to find a little stump out in the woods and to stand on it, and he would practice what people would say to him, from preachers to the different talkers that he would hear. And he was increasing in his volume. And it was said by adults later that he had a high, shrill voice. Now, in our day, that description does not fit what I understand and what I have witnessed that it means today. A high, shrill voice in that day meant that he could carry over acreage. If at 10 years of age, people were talking about him repeating speeches that he had heard verbatim, he didn't talk about the speeches that he was repeating, and neither did his father. If anything, it would have embarrassed his father. But it was only because he was doing a good job, and the messages of other people's speeches were getting across even better than the original speaker had projected it. As other people, farms away, were doing their chores, they were listening to Abraham Lincoln doing his recitations. Now, if somebody later, especially during our White House years, happened to be on a podium with us and happened to have their ear in a direction when my husband was turned his head in his projection, I'm sure they felt it was a high, shrill voice and about did their head and ear in. They could hear him. And he had what you call, what we would call, a bass tenor range. He would project inside. When he got outside, he could project it. And it would sound, it depends on how far away or how near you were, whether his inflections would appear in the wider range of the tenor or closer to a mellow tone at the bass. But he also whispered in my ear. And that never hurt. Also, when we got together, it was our similarities that made us close, not our differences. He educated himself. He read what he could. When we first, our first time together, we compared what we felt about the Euclid. I had been allowed to attend Transylvania University. I had a father who in that time, did you know that little girls were not allowed to learn to read and write when I was little? How would you feel about that? And little girls, we are almost considered naughty if we could write. But all the boys were taught to read and write who lived on the plantations who would allow them to attend schools. So it was very rare that I had a papa in Lexington, Kentucky, where I was born and grew up, that let me go to a school. And it also helped, you see, my real mama passed away when I was about 6 and a half. And she had had 7 children. One had passed away, leaving my father with 6, and he dutifully married a lovely young lady who was the daughter of a doctor in the area. And she dutifully bore him 8 more children in the next 13 years. So we had slaves and servants under our household as well. And with the 2 different households that we had going on, there was just a little bit of friction. You know what friction is? Sometimes we didn't get along. You never fight. Would you ever fight? Sometimes. Well, we did. In fact, we would think up things on purpose just to see how someone was going to react to us, just to see how good we were with just a word or two. Well, my father in Lexington, Kentucky had a mercantile. Do you know what a mercantile is? No? Okay. It was a large, large building, and it had, now you have today what you call a mall with a lot of shops in it. Well, my father had one large building that had everything in one building, from boots for riding, to saddles, to the bits for the horses, to fresh produce, which is fruits and vegetables, grains. He was into cotton warehousing and beautiful finery and silks that were imported with our silks and satin and our laces. So as a young child, I learned what the materials were. And then Mama at home, when we had the finest minds, you know what it means to have a fine mind? What's a fine mind? How many fine minds do we have here today? Everyone should raise their hand. That's good. When you have a fine mind, that means you are smart. That means you have learned and you have listened and you remember what you've learned. So we had some of the finest minds that would come and eat at our table in Lexington, Kentucky. Now, why do you think the finest minds were invited to sit and eat with us? Papa would bring from his mercantile the finest silver and gold trays. We would be dressed in the finest attire. He had a carriage house that he would show the men the latest saddles and the bits and a plow equipment for their fields within their plantations. There was many a ticket and a sale from our residence as there was in the mercantile. And on top of that, Papa was in politics. What's politics? What's politics? That's when you're elected to an office to serve somebody other than yourself. Isn't that nice? People who want to do things for other people. Now that is not always easy to do, because someone wants you to do one thing and somebody else wants you to do another thing about the same thing. And you have to decide what's best for a whole lot of people, don't you? All right. So he was one of the first clerks in our Kentucky House of Representatives, and he was elected repeatedly as a clerk. And he was also the president of our first branch bank in Kentucky. I see you have a beautiful bank across the way here in Chatham. Well, my papa had the first bank in Lexington. And as a result, in later years, I did not always trust the banking establishments. And I wound up in later years keeping on my possession and sewn in my petticoats over 55,000 in currency, in monies. And of course, there were different currency from the Confederate to the Union to the railroad to the bank. It depends on where you were as to what you could spend. The only way that was going to be taken from me was when our oldest son, Robert, at the time, years later, he had me put in the hospital, and they called that committed. They were wondering about my thinking, weren't they, at that time. And he proved to a great deal of people, not only was he a good lawyer himself, and he was a good spokesman. What's a spokesman? It means he's a good talker. Okay. Well, he proved what he could do with finances within his practicing law. And after that, he was awarded the positions of Secretary of War, Minister to Great Britain, the President of the Pullman Railroad Company. He brought the railroad company through one of the largest periods of financial growth in the history of the Pullman Railroad Company, and he retired on the board. The Pullman Railroad Company. Pullman. Pullman Railroad Company. Mm-hmm. All right. So, now they always told me when I was little that I would jump from one subject to another subject. Do you all have your thinking caps on? I am 175 this year, and I don't think my pattern of speech has changed much. Once when I was, we lived right next door to my real grandmama. Now see, remember I told you that my real mama passed away, and then Papa married another lovely lady, and she became a what to me? A stepmother, right. And as I got older, I learned to appreciate what she went through in raising two different families. But as a child, when I didn't want to do what she told me to do, I would run next door to my Grandmama Parker, who was the mother, my real mother, you see. And definitely she would take my side. And I was running through her house one day, and she says, Mary, what on earth is ever going to become of you? I'm going to be a president's wife. And I was. And as I ran out, she said, well, you better be ahead of your time and pick a president before the nation does. I was full of questions to Papa. I was upset with Papa because he didn't want to run for the presidency so I could grow up in the White House. But I did ask Papa questions as to things would come up in the legislature, and Papa would come over to me and he would tap me on my shoulder and he'd say, now, little Miss Mary, you see, little Miss Mary, you just be careful about that White House someday, because right now you wouldn't have a man in your household with you. You would be on your own because of what's going on in the country. And Papa had a study. We're now in a library, and Papa had a beautiful library in our home. And he had beautiful tooled books that had gold edgings on the outside of them. And I would go in there, and I'd sneak in there. We children were not supposed to go in there. But I wanted to be able to understand what was in those books. At that time, I didn't always understand, or nor could I read all those words just yet. But Papa finally relinquished and let me be educated. And as I got older, I attended the Transylvania University, where Jefferson Davis, who later became the president of the Confederacy against my husband in the White House, where he had gone, and we had even studied under the same professors. Well, before my real mama passed away, I'm taking you back now a little bit, Mama took me to Papa's Mercantile. And she didn't feel well during that last pregnancy. You're going to have to put your feet up, sweetie. Sweet up. And just a little back. Can you push just a little back? Thank you. I wouldn't want to step on your toes. Because you see, I know you're, that's a hoop skirt. And when I come forward, my feet have to be in the middle of that. And we don't want to get hung up on your toe. Is that all right? Okay, that's good. Well, we went through the mercantile, and I was seated up on a stool. And we had gathered the gloves, the leather gloves for riding, furry gloves, lacy gloves, gloves that even had the fingers out of them. Why would gloves have fingers out of them? They would. It was the riding gloves. They would blister your hands with the reins. So we would wear gloves for that, but we still wanted to show how delicately and how fine our fingertips were. They were considered ladies' gloves. That's right. And as we went through, before Mama had one glove in one hand, she knew who'd moved in the area and who'd moved out, what political party they belonged to, financially, how independent they were. And I kicked Mama underneath the table, and she said I was the one that always asked too many questions. Well, that was the day that I learned how to learn the lay of the land myself. We learned that day that when my Grandmama Parker had guests, they stood on the side porch, and they'd look over into the yard that was catty corner in the back. They had a slave home over there, and they would pick the finest slaves for purchase from her side porch to go over and buy to later set free. And that was the day that I learned that John C. Breckinridge, who became a vice president, ran against my later to be husband for the presidency. We used to play in the sand pile, and we would make replica White Houses. And I had a shovel that had a hollow handle, and I would make the prettiest little columns you'd ever want to see. And when mine was obviously much better than his, they would say that it showed that John C. Breckinridge had political leanings even as a young lad, because he would plop down and sit on mine. Political leanings, indeed. And then, of course, there was Jefferson Davis, who would come over and play chess with Papa. And again, I was the only child allowed in the area. And I would put my hand up the back of Papa's leg, and I'd pull on the hair on the back of his leg when I thought Papa was going to make a wrong move. I could beat Jefferson Davis at his game as a child. I certainly could help later beat him at a larger game. Well, I learned, you see, also that day that Jefferson Davis was selfish, stingy, and he could not be flexible. What does it mean to be flexible? Move easy, that's a good answer. That's true, to move easy and to be able to change your mind if it's for the betterment of other people, and to delegate, let somebody else do something that you appointed and let them do it because maybe they can do something better than you, but that you're smart enough to let them do it. That's being flexible. But when I returned home that day, Mama had the clerk, of course, wrap up, a dozen or so of gloves. And she said to me that the clerk will never remember all that she told us that day, but she would certainly remember the large sale that she had written up, because we bought so many different types and kinds that it kept her busy keeping her order together. And I learned, you see, all throughout the rest of my life, I bought dozens and dozens. I had trunkfuls of gloves. Does anyone know what happened to my gloves? You do? What? Got lost? They might have, or someone might have them in a collection and they're not ready to release them yet. I am one of the most collected women in the world. And the people who have had my paraphernalia within their collections haven't been as safe to even announce that they have some of my pieces of my materials, the gloves, for their own safety and the safety of their collection. It is just now being they could share. So if anyone ever comes across a pair of my gloves, please let me know. And so you see, throughout life, I would purchase gloves and learn the lay of the land. And I always remembered my real mama, because she passed away about a half year after that. So every time, too, if I would just miss her, I would go and purchase gloves. Well, pretty soon, there was a governor of Illinois, and he sent his son Ninian to Lexington, Kentucky, to go to Transylvania University. He was a boy, so he was able to be what? Educated. Mm-hmm. Go to school. That's right. So he wrote my father a letter saying, please have Ninny and Edwards to dinner so they won't get into any problems in Lexington, Kentucky. Not getting any problems coming to our home. These two men had their heads together, and yes, nature took its course. And my sister Elizabeth fell in love with Ninny. At age 16, they were wed, and he took her to a place called Springfield, Illinois. You know where that is? You do. You do? Well, good. Good. Well, we got letters from Springfield, Illinois. And she told us when they left that she was never going to miss us because of all the squabbling that we did with all of the different children in the house, the two different families going on in there. She said she's never going to miss us. And she was glad to be gone. And one by one, my sisters moved from my real blood first mother, moved here to Springfield. And one by one, they were being married off. And one by one, they were writing to me saying, come to Springfield, Illinois. I didn't know if the trip was going to be worth it, because you see, in that day, we women could not travel by ourselves. So if Papa had to take me part of the way. And then a John Stewart came, a cousin, member of our family, many members of our family just besides Papa's household, were moving to this area. We had to be escorted all the way in. And as I got off the coach coming into Springfield, the wind was a-blowing, my bonnet rolled off, I stepped into mud to just about there, and the humidity and the dust, it just all stuck to me. And I said, "This is Illinois?" They came up to me, wrapped their arms around me, and he says, "Well, would you have come if we told you?" Well, naturally, one of the first things they did was to start introducing me to the area. Now, this is something that's different. When we were introduced to people, we would go to a large dance or a gala affair, and we had little dance cards. And you would be introduced to somebody when you just first went. All right, then it took another attendance at a similar affair for them to write their name on a dance card, to have a dance with you. Then it took a third function for them to get the dance with us, because we had enough time to research who that person was who had signed our card. And if we didn't want to have a dance with that young man, we just wouldn't arrive at the next function. We were very protected. And do you know who we could dance with while all these people and all this time was taking place to get to know people? Who could we dance with? The clergy and family. I think the clergy had more fun than anybody of the day. Well, Stephen Douglas and I became a twosome. A twosome. People would think of us together when they think of two people dancing on a floor. A twosome means we became great friends, didn't we? And as he got signing his name on my card, he realized, you see, that with our political standing in the Todd family, it didn't do him any harm to have more dances out in that dance floor with me, did it? So he started putting his name on my card more often. He'd take me for buggy rides out in the country. And he thought that if we had railroads coming from the south up to the north, that people could get along better and we could have better communication, that people wouldn't argue about all the talk that was coming up about the South seceding and all the states wanting to be a separate entity from the north, that he thought the railroads was the answer. So more and more, you see, I was having his name on my dance card. But look at the names on my dance card today. There are 7 members of an elected board in Chatham, Illinois. I'm going to have a lovely dance with them. Would you please come up and share a new building that I hear is going to be built in the name of education, in the name of sharing what we know, and the wonderful books we're going to have, and the lovely times we're going to have in a new building. Would you introduce yourself, please?
I'm Jean Barnes, president of the board in Chatham. And here come some other members of the board. Chuck Kerr.
Hi, do you, Chuck?
Jean Wilkin.
Jean.
Hi.
Diane Hayes.
Hayes, Diane.
Well, we have a quorum. Well, I think it's no secret to anyone that we need a larger library building. You can look around today and see how crowded we are, and it's obvious that we need a new building. It's no secret that the community is growing.
That's marvelous.
And it's no secret that the patrons are asking for expanded library service. It's no secret that the staff is working very hard to give more and better service. And before I get done, I'm going to talk about some of the staff that is here today. It's no secret that the time has come to increase our space here. It's no secret that we need a new building. The board we've worked hard over the past several months. In fact, before the 5th anniversary celebration that we had here just last in November of 91. Even before that, we were talking and planning on how we could give this community the kind of library that it needs and wants and deserves. It's no secret that we need a bigger building and a new building. The plans for that building are no longer a secret. Here they are.
That's beautiful. Look
Mary,
at this building.
Mary, how would you like to have that kind of a library?
Oh, indeed. I'd like to have that alongside of a new home. A new home in remembrance of my return. Go ahead.
The board will be here for a while. Afterwards, we'll answer questions. The staff, I know, will be happy to answer questions today, even though the sign on the door said they weren't to do library work. We have Linda Meyer, our director, here today. All of you who are patrons know the staff, but Linda's here. Marilyn Smith, one of our staff members, is here. Maxine McCoy, a staff member, is in the doorway, and I see out there we have Vicki Alexander and Carmen Epstein, and I don't know whether there are any other staff members around or not, but you all know them as well as I do, so after we hear some more about Mary Todd Lincoln and her growing up and her love of libraries and books, then we'll all be around to answer questions.
Will you tell us what the rooms are there? Just show us what the rooms are, just real quickly. This is so beautiful.
Well, back in here is staff area. This would be a staff entrance. We have storage room, and then the workspace for the director's office, bookkeeping. This is technical services and circulation area. Then this is the circulation desk. This is the entranceway, restroom, the public meeting room, more storage and mechanical services. Then we have a children's area here, a children's activity area, which we desperately need.
Desperately.
In this community. We have the children's stack, young adult literature here. Then we have fiction, nonfiction, reference work, and areas back here for private study and tutoring. And then we have areas where patrons can use typewriters and things of that sort. So, and then area right down through the middle, which is referred to on the plan here as Main Street, which will, when you come in, you'll be able to look and go down Main Street and into the area that you want to be. We have tables, areas to sit and study and work and read. A glass area out here for periodicals where patrons will be able to sit and read and enjoy the papers and the magazines that we have. Out here's another glass area that will be light and pretty and bright and beautiful for our community. We're very anxious to see this get off of the ground and up to where we can use it.
This is marvelous, marvelous. It's wonderful to see how a few books from Papa's study and throughout the world, and that with women in the learning place heading up projects for a new library, this is a thrill.
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you. As well as the gentlemen. Without you men, we still need you men. We want you to carry in the tables. Don't you love that? On my second return to Springfield, guess who was up on the front porch of that Ninian Edwards place with a card in his hand? Who do you think was there? Stephen Douglas. And this time he had signed every line on the card. All right, gala affair. It takes 4.5 hours to prepare oneself just for a buggy ride, not to say another 3 hours. For a gala affair. I never did meet the requirements of the decor, let alone what we would wear for our day at any one period in my life. Even as a child, I was one of the only ones that would sneak out in the back and let the servants teach me the stitchery. And I was allowed, even as a child, to go over the patterns and to be in on the orders of the fine materials that Papa would have in his mercantile. So naturally, I became accustomed to beautiful jewelry, and it was considered less than a lady and even a sin to show your earlobes. but I would always show my jewelry. Well, I feel somebody looking at me all evening long. Do you see a shadow of somebody in the back? Well, we came up, and it was a break time when they had beautiful punch bowls made of the different fruits that we would have. And the men would congregate in the back, and they'd bring the punch to the ladies. And we'd sit on these beautiful settees that were up toward the refreshment area. And they were horse's hair material. They were woven horse's hair, like the tails of a horse, all woven together for the material. It would last forever. It was marvelous. But if they broke, it would stick you when you'd sit on them. All right, these beautiful settees, they had carved wooden pieces on the arms. It was not only comfortable, but it was fun to be displayed with all your finery on these beautiful settees. Well, there was Stephen Douglas back at the punch bowl, talking about his railroads again. I wish he would hurry up, because look at all you people waiting to come up for your turn to get the punch. And I was making small talk, and all of a sudden, a large man's hand took a hold of my left hand. It was being raised higher and higher. All the eyes in Springfield were upon us. Do I dare look? I look back. Douglas, will you please pay attention? He was busy. My hand was being raised higher and higher. I looked up, and there stood a tall, very tall, gangly fella. His hair was askew and stuck up like here and here. I didn't know if his pants were supposed to touch his shoes or not, or if his coat jacket was supposed to be short sleeves or not. But he looked at me through and through, and his eyes were just a-dancing. And he said, "Little Miss Mary, I'd like to dance with you in the worst way." And he most certainly did. I did what I shouldn't, and he had already done what he shan't. My few cousins ran up. They were mumbling some sort of an introduction in the back. Neither one of us could remember later who properly had introduced us. But everybody in the family had claimed that they'd had a proper introduction by them, of course. Well, he waltzed me out on the dance floor, and he was afraid that his big feet were going to step on my toes. And as he waltzed me around, he would lift me up and twirl me, and everyone saw everything. Oh, dear. And Mr. Douglas stopped talking about his railroads, I noticed. When we got home that evening, here stood my sister, Elizabeth. "Don't you know you're not to be seen with the likes of Mr. Lincoln?" "Oh, yes, he's all right to do the business of the day and the legal papers of the time. But there's nobody in this whole area that is inviting him to dine at their table with their single ladies. This is not acceptable." I said, "Elizabeth, thou dost protest too much. I have heard Ninian go through this house saying, 'Where is Abraham? Where is Abraham?' when there was a vote. Abraham would always make sure that both sides of an argument had been taken within the legislature that he at that time was a part of. But you see, if Abraham was down at the store telling a story about another issue, or if he was about other business elsewhere, they wouldn't show up for a vote either, because it was something that had nothing to do with the necessity of them voting on it. Even at that time, he was becoming a peer within the community. Indeed, indeed, they just didn't want us to link together." And of course, Elizabeth, in her letters and everything else, from the visitation of Ninian's cousin that would come at a later time to visit, would have him more interested and in love with anyone but me. Well, to make a long story short, on our second attempt at being wed, the rain was coming down, and the shutters were flapping, and Mr. Lincoln was downtown, and he was crossing the street, and he bumped right into Ninian. And we had planned to be wed at a minister's home in private because of the Edwards family not wanting us to be together. And Mr. Lincoln had even written to Papa in Lexington, Kentucky, and asked for my hand. And Papa had written to everybody in the family. They'd answered all of Papa's questions, but not anything about Mr. Lincoln, so naturally he could not reply. Well, during the period of time that it took for us to have a date for a wedding and Mr. Lincoln not appearing because he didn't want me to be disowned by my family, he knew what he had gone through in being good enough to do their legal work but not good enough to be at their tables. He didn't feel that I was strong enough to buck that. Well, in the next 2 years, I made sure that Papa in Lexington, Kentucky had centers of influence praising Mr. Lincoln. And here stands Ninian and Mr. Lincoln in the middle of the street, the rain pouring down, and Mr. Lincoln tells Ninian that we're going to be wed that next day. Well, here's Elizabeth again. At top pitch, but this time here's Ninian in the background. No, it's going to go. They talked me into having the wedding at their home instead of at the minister's home. We passed out a few invitations that gave us enough time to have about 32 in attendance. Elizabeth thought, well, it would be nice to have us wed on the day the religious society was meeting, and they could surprise the afternoon ladies with the tea and a wedding. No. The very women and the folk that we had kept all this from was not going to be a sideshow for their ladies' tea. All right. That put the wedding off a day. And Mr. Lincoln did not know when he started for the Edwards place whether I was going to be there when he arrived, whether he was going to be stood up the way he'd stood me up 2 years prior. So everyone was arriving. Ninian had given someone a gold piece to come late. I kept looking down. They cinched me in as tightly as we could. The shutters were a-flapping. Finally, we could hear someone being brushed off, and Mr. Lincoln had arrived. We were wed that day. The cake was still warm from the oven, and he took me to the Globe Tavern to live at the top, where the town people would come to take a town bath, and they all used the same town towel. My family was very happy to count up to 9 months, just a few days short, for the arrival of our first son, Robert. All right. We were wed in 42. Robert was born in 43. Then we had little Eddie in 43. And little Eddie lived to almost his fourth birthday. And the year of his passing, we had little Willie that was in 1850. 3 years later, we had little Tad. And because when he was born, he looked like he had a small body and such a big head, I knew he was going to be wonderful and brilliant. We called him our little Taddy. And Willie and Taddy had a great time together. They had a great love one for another. They played together, they jested together, and they were what you call pranksters. Of course, we've barely touched on the Stephen and Douglas debates. Stephen Douglas won the Senate because he approached and spoke to issues within the state of Illinois. Whether Illinois knew it or not, my father, the father of our household, the father of our children, was running for the presidency. And those debates, when Father talked more about national issues, when it came time for the election, he let his reputation stand for him within the debates with Stephen Douglas. And we would have within our household, when he was gone on the circuit, our father was gone, I'd say, two-thirds of the year. And every week we would learn a scripture from the Old and New Testament. We would act out one of the classics that we would teach. We would play church. The children played church. The ladies, and especially I, was a congregation about every other afternoon. We'd be playing that. And they would learn a poem once a week. Now, naturally, have you ever watched a child wait for a parent to come, and when they're late, and they wait, and they wait, and they wait, and they want that parent, and they long to be with that parent, and when that parent comes home, that parent is so popular that all of Springfield wants the time with that parent too? Well, naturally, I would sit at the top window when Father would come home. And if it was business that could be taken care of in the office, they could meet with him in the office. Only if they had a pre-invitation to her home for a private gathering. Most of the people who knew how important it was for the time that he had with us, they would honor that, and most of the time they would go to his office before even trying to come to the home. It wasn't that I didn't want some of these folk in our home. It was that they honored Abraham's request to share part of his loving time with his sons. So when they say that our children were not schooled in the letters, you take a child that has a father as magnificent as Abraham Lincoln, and what they learned from him, he never told a funny story without there being a lesson involved with it. It was time. Time is the greatest gift we have to give. And the time that he shared in the home, the time he shared at the office, the time he shared with the country, I had to learn to balance and juggle that time so that we could be as healthy a couple and that I could back him, because naturally it had been my desire as a child to live in the White House. There is a poem that signifies our time in Springfield and the transition time into the White House. When we, my sister Elizabeth would tell me that in wedding Abraham, I would be left hollow and empty inside by the end of my life. And there was a turning point in our life when Abraham Lincoln was offered the Oregon Territory, and he felt that politically, at that point in his life, that was as far as he would go. He wanted to accept the position, and I had a fit. I yelled and screamed, "Abraham!" And I told him that it was an honor from his constituency, that they wanted to put him out in the field and get him out of their way, and that he'd better not take the position of the governor of the Oregon Territory, that if he did, he would go without us, because I and the boys were going to the White House. I kept this up for 6 weeks straight, and I know everyone thinks that it's impossible for me to have ever lost my voice. Finally, when I was down to a whisper, "Now I know you men have never put yourselves in a position where you even halfway deserved a silent treatment, or you even know what one is. But I gave my husband a silent treatment that helped, mind you, get him all the way to the White House." We were receiving letters of threats on our lives, not only for ourselves, but our children, but especially for Mr. Lincoln. So in the process, I taught the boys "The Spider and the Fly" by Mary Hallett. It related, it got them the fun out, and it took the tension away, because they had to give up pets and home and friends to accompany us. "Will you walk into my parlor?" said the spider to the fly. "'Tis the prettiest little parlor that ever you did spy. The way into my parlor is up a winding stair, and I have many pretty things to show while you are there." "No, no, no," said the little fly. "To ask me is in vain, for who goes up your winding stair can ne'er come down again. I'm sure you must be weary, dear, with soaring up so high. Will you rest upon my little bed?" said the spider to the fly. "There are pretty curtains drawn around. The sheets are fine and thin. If you care to rest a while, I'll snugly tuck you in." "Oh, no, no," said the little fly. "I've often heard it said they never wake again who sleep upon your bed." Said the cunning spider to the fly, "Dear friend, what shall I do to prove the warm affection I've always felt for you? I have within my pantry good store of all that's nice. I'm sure you're very welcome. Will you please take a slice?" "Oh, no, no," said the little fly. "Kind sir, that cannot be. I've heard what's in your pantry, and I do not wish to see. So sweet creature, said the spider, you're witty and you're wise. How handsome are your gauzy wings, how brilliant are your eyes. I have a little looking glass upon my parlor shelf. If you'll step in one moment, dear, you shall behold yourself. I thank you, gentle sir, she said, for what you're pleased to say. But bidding you good morning now, I'll call another day. The spider turned him round about and went into his den, for well he knew the silly fly would soon be back again. So he wove a subtle web in a little corner sly, and he set his table ready to dine upon the fly. Then he came out to his door again, and merrily did sing, come hither, hither, pretty fly, with pearl and silver wing. Your robes are green and purple, there's a crest upon your head. Your eyes are like the diamond bright, but mine are dull as lead. Alas, how very soon the silly little fly, hearing his wily flattering words, came slowly flitting by. With buzzing wings she hung aloft, and nearer drew, thinking only of her brilliant eyes and green and purple hue, thinking only of her crescent head, poor foolish thing. At last up jumped the cunning spider and fiercely held her fast. He dragged her up his winding stair into his dismal den within his little parlor, but she never came out again. And now, dear little children who may this story read, to idle, silly, flattering words, I pray you ne'er give heed. Unto an evil counselor, close heart and ear and eye, and take a lesson from this tale of the spider and the fly. Now, one such letter, thank you, one such letter that we received had told Father that by the time we arrived in Washington, that they want him to resign from having been elected president, or they were going to put a fly in his ointment and play the devil with him. They most certainly did. All right. We knew what the spider and the fly was about. I certainly wasn't going to change that much when I got to the White House. I wasn't out of character. They were. The history that was revolved around me, and I'm sure my reactions to it, the people that made their livings off of not only my father's coattails, but on watching my reactions, I had 12 negative columns written about me from the day I stepped through the threshold of the White House to my departure. Also, the boys, of course, were in true form. We were going to an outing, and because they didn't want their billy goats, who were their pets, to get too much involved with the gardener and eating, they were eating the gardener's roses they were putting together for the centerpieces on our beautiful banquets that we were having. They smuggled the goats up to our bedrooms for safekeeping during this outing, and when we returned, the goats had eaten most of the White House bedspread. Also, the mulatto ladies were starting to arrive. And I was very disappointed when my own staff made them go around to the side entrance for me to see them. And they were asking for funding, and they were asking for any type of help that they could get in order for their children and their families to be educated so that those who were free could take care of themselves. And so we had an array. I would have them bring all their quilts and the stitching that they did, and the quilts they put out were some of the finest in the land. In fact, I would say in the world. And people would come and they'd look at their quilts, but it got to the point where sometimes I would have to put a surname on a quilt, and I would put one of their quilts in with a function that I was able to attend, and then that part of the monies I would give to them to help toward educating for their freedom. We have such a quilt in here today. It's been handmade. It is absolutely beautiful. It took years and years for the ladies' auxiliaries to start publicly putting quilts out other than for their own private needs. And I am glad to see this beautiful quilt today, and that I understand you've taken chances on it. And whoever gets this in just a few minutes here, would you please be so kind and just let us have this still here until the end of our question and answer time. Could I have the glass jar? Will you tell us, please, your name and how this came to be and who stitched this lovely piece of work?
I'm Meredith Fay, and I'm at Chatham, the library. The quilt was made by my mother-in-law, Ruby Fay, and she lives in England, Illinois. Spencer Winter quilting quilt, and this one she donated to the friends to raise money for our new library. She's very well acquainted with the Lincolns, because they have a Bryant cottage there in town, and she occasionally is asked to come and stay at the Bryant cottage during the day so it can be kept open. Bryant cottage is where Stephen Douglas and Abraham Lincoln agreed to have the debate, and that is the cornerstone of the inn.
Who wants the quilt? I do too. All right, rustle it around. Have some fun with this a little bit. Rustle it around. All right. All right. Pick one. All right. And you may read it.
To Bobby Taylor. Is Bobby Taylor here today? Looks like a Chatham number.
A Chatham.
Junior high principal, we'll have to give her a call.
Now, see, this is wonderful. We are going to have a new library from the past coming forth for tomorrow, and someone associated with education has picked up on the quilt. Thank you so very, very much.
You. Thank you very much.
We didn't feel that it was going to be easy for Father to win the second election. Jefferson Davis had the fifth column come down from, he had a group of people that would say that isn't it better for the southern states to be allowed legally to separate from the north and to have their own entity because of all the men that had been killed in the war to date. But what they didn't count on was that the families who had lost these husbands and sons had to have a reason that was worthwhile to keep in their minds to validate the rest of their lives and living without them. Father's reelection happened because the war had to go on. He was reelected not only because it was Abraham Lincoln they wanted as president, but because they wanted us to remain the United States of America. And when President Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, it was the beginning of a beautiful era for a beautiful race of people to be able to free themselves and to be happy within our shore. The night before the assassination, there were boats in on the harbor that had come in. And a man had come up wanting Father to sign this document to load up all of the blacks to put on the boat, take them back to their homeland. And Father paused and he said, "We will discuss and handle that tomorrow." Father's mission in this life had been served. I had loved him all my life. The men that came back after that second election were men who were coming back with one arm and one leg, one lung. They had been educated through their service in this war. They thought the war was only going to last a few months and they'd be back by harvest. They weren't back by harvest. It took 4 years. We have today the United States of America. I had the foresight, by the grace of God, to pick a president before the nation did. He gave me four beautiful sons. We lost little Eddie before he was four in Springfield. We lost Willie in the White House at age 12. He was shot by an assassin's bullet, and I lost little Tad at age 18 upon returning from Europe. I went back to Europe. I got boils. My blood wasn't good. I got down to about 98 pounds, and I was hanging a picture over a mantle, and I fell, and I partially paralyzed one part of my body, and I wanted to go home. And where was a home for me to go to but Sister Elizabeth? And at this time, I want to tell you that it was because of Elizabeth that I met Abraham Lincoln. And it was because of Elizabeth that I came to Springfield to be able to meet him. And it was because of Elizabeth that in the end of my life, I had a place to lay my head. All throughout our years, before the boys were born, during Springfield, and especially during our White House time together, Father would find me, and he would tell me stories and hold my hand, and he would read the scriptures as well as the classics and Shakespeare to me. The one verse that he would recite and read over and over again, which even Robert, who outlived all of us, he lived almost his 82nd birthday. And because he heard Father recite the 23rd Psalm over and over and over again, he had even requested that it be read at his funeral, which at that time later it was. The 23rd Psalm is our legacy. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. As I was at Elizabeth's home, I went into a coma, and I could hear her crying beside the bed. And I wanted to say, oh, Elizabeth, don't cry. I am happy. There is someone here, Elizabeth, and he has a large hand. And oh, Elizabeth, he has just taken my hand in his, and he is raising it higher and higher and higher. And oh, Elizabeth, yes, he's known me most of my life, and his eyes are just dancing, and I love him so. Father has come, and he is taking me home. The ring that I wore on my finger had inscribed within it, love is eternal. And I'm here to share with you that love is eternal. Thank you for your time. Time is the greatest gift that we have to give. Thank you. Are there any questions about the new library? About our life, or about the quilt? Any questions? Yes. It was the Edwards, Governor Edwards. And it was Ninian was his son, who came to Transylvania and married my sister Elizabeth.
Ninian Edwards Father.
Yes. Yes. I'm going to give you the challenge, and I want you to read a book in this library. I'm going to refer you to the head librarian. The name that it'll be the I don't know what they're going to call the is it going to call it the Chatham Library? We need someone from the library. Would you like to come forward here and answer that question? I don't know what you're going to call it. Area. I would like to make mention that Stephen Douglas, of course, before his passing away, shortly after we arrived in Washington, through his support to Abraham Lincoln. And the monies that they said that I overspent on refining the White House, nobody told me that there was $4,000 that they had used to fill in the cracks with concrete for the pillars in the White House and for paint. I looked all over for the beautiful wallpaper that donations to the new library is appreciated. If anyone wanted to have matching fund project of any kind or privately donate through the Friends of Chatham Library, it is more than appreciated. This is a wonderful project, and I know it will be a great success. Thank you for coming.